expressed by the individuals during this broadcast are their own opinions, and they may not be the same as those of their group or other organizations they may be involved with.
Man, what's the matter with that cat there?
What people are reaping.
What a reaper?
Yeah, man.
Mean that cat's high?
Failing.
Sadly.
Feeling like.
We now wander off the beaten path with an update from the Reefer Reporter.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Reefer Reporters. I'm joined by my joint host, Cindy Howell, and, of course, myself, Kim Cooper. Today, February the 18th in 2021, we are here live from the Legacy420.com news desk on the People Advocating Cannabis Education Radio Network, found at paceradio.net. We've got a bunch of stories on tap for you today. 10 to be exact. We've got news coming at you from around the globe. How's lovely Cindy today?
Cindy's doing absolutely fabulous this morning. And how are you doing this morning, Kim?
I'm doing great. I'm energized. I'm energized and charged. Lots going on here at the network and with myself and, of course, with you launching new shows and busy all over the place.
Exciting stuff.
And lots going on in the cannabis world. Today we are going to start off the show with a sad note. It's probably not news to most, but it may be to those of us that are not here in Canada. The Canadian cannabis community suffered a great loss this past week. We've got our first news story coming at us to us from CannabisLifeNetwork.com. Great picture on the cover of this. Goodbye to marijuana man. Greg Williams passed away last week.
Yeah, it was very sad news indeed. He's done a lot for the cannabis community. The cannabis community is grieving the loss of Greg Williams, a.k.a. marijuana man, as he passed away from cancer. Well-known and well-liked Greg Williams was a grassroots cannabis activist. If you have smoked bud in Canada, there's a possibility that it's linked to the genetics he distributed. He brought mail order seeds from cannabis, or have you bought mail order seeds from cannabis culture? He wrote the how-to instructions that were included with each order. You might also remember him as the MC of cannabis events such as 420 Vancouver or Cannabis Day. He got involved at a time when cannabis was viewed as an illicit drug and put himself at risk to change the stigma. Yeah. He worked hard and it made a difference. It really did make a huge difference. People like this gentleman, and respect should be shown where it is due. There have been tributes all week to this gentleman.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Back in 96, he started working at Emory Direct Seed. Marijuana seed bank, and of course that's the case that got Mark thrown in jail was through that seed bank. So he was part of all that, and he ran the seed desk at Cannabis Culture headquarters in Vancouver for years. So I mean, he's got a long history in the community, and you know, even if you don't know him personally, if you are a grower or have grown in Canada, chances are those seeds pass through this man's hands. You know, he's touched everybody, and he advocated for change at a time when it wasn't a popular thing to do. And he grew our community as we know it now, as well as the plants.
Oh, absolutely. He's paved the way for you know, today's advocates and activists to be able to do what we do in a much more secure world. We have less fears than he had when he was starting out, and I'm very thankful for people like this gentleman, Mr. Williams.
Yeah, absolutely. There's some great shots in this article. You know, Greg with the top hat on, puffing on a dude with some jars, and then down below that is, you know, with him with Jody Emery, you know, flashing the peace signs. So, you know, I love that one.
Absolutely.
For sure. You know, it was definitely a sad day losing a cannabis activist that made such a serious difference to our cause right here in Canada and around the globe. Yeah, you may you rest in peace, Marijuana Man.
Marijuana Man.
Yeah, yeah. So that day. From there, we're going to go on to regular news. Just give me a second here. Regular news. Our top story for today in regular news is coming to us from Marijuana Business Daily. Another one jumping on the bandwagon here. Canadian marijuana retailer Fire and Flower seeks a Nasdaq listing.
Yes, Fire and Flower Holdings, which is a Canadian cannabis retail chain, has an eye on international growth, and it applied to list its shares on the Nasdaq exchange in the United States.
Yeah.
Going
south of the border. Now, I mean, people that out there are just like, yeah, well, it's just another stock exchange. This is a big deal. Getting on your company onto the United States Stock Exchange is no easy task. Your company has to become compliant with a number of measures on a number of levels. It's a big deal. There are auditors up your ass and on your back making sure that you follow the protocol that you have to follow in order to remain on the U.S. Stock Exchange. So because it opens doors to such a larger market, there are definitely more stringent rules and protocols involved in order to be listed there.
Yep, absolutely. You know, they will continue to pursue domestic and international opportunities for accelerated growth in the years ahead, and they look forward to updating and broadening shareholder base as they move forward. That was Trevor Fencott, who was the CEO of Fire and Flower. They reported a revenue of $33.1 million Canadian for the most recent quarter.
Yeah, yeah. I love the line right after that, which is, of course, a net loss of $25.7 million. But that's okay in their books because, you know, they're making money even though they're losing money. Yeah, the stock market, it's a mind-boggling situation for sure. Fire and Flower, of course, owns and operates cannabis stores in Alberta, Manitoba, Ontario, Saskatchewan, and the Yukon Territory. And Canada-based international convenience store operator Alimentation Couche-Tard is also an investor in the company. So we'll watch for an evolving situation with Fire and Flower.
Absolutely.
From there, we're going to go local to me here in Northern Ontario. We're going to talk a bit about a story coming at us from timminstoday.com. This one bugs me on so many levels. There's bits and pieces to discuss. Such a short story. It's amazing how much controversy this has brought up. Kirkland Lake driver has been charged after police seize suspected cannabis.
So on February 16th, at approximately 2 a.m., members of the Kirkland Lake detachment of the OPP conducted a traffic stop on a motor vehicle on Duncan Avenue. The investigation revealed that the driver was breaching a recognizance and was in possession of drugs suspected to be cannabis. I just hate that word for our medicine.
Yeah, and that there's the rub right there, right?
Yeah.
The choice of words obviously put forth by the officer and recorded by the reporter. The choice of words is shining a spotlight. I mean, this is a small town. Rural Canada. Okay. And like all small towns in rural Canada, everybody knows everybody. So even if you don't know their face, their name, you know their face. So this person was obviously in trouble previously. Breach recognizance. Okay. If he wasn't supposed to be out, then they have a reason to pull you over. If, you know, he was breaking some sort of rule based on, you know, an order from a judge, then they have the right to pull you over. But obviously they were watching him and they were waiting for that opportunity, rightfully so or not. They did. They waited for that opportunity. But then they're in possession of drugs suspected to be cannabis. Well, number one, just saying, oh, they're in possession of drugs, You're using that terminology in order to create a scenario, hands mm-hmm. down. That's why you're using that. And it's to be cannabis, but you know it's pot. You know 100% hands down it's pot. If he had a bottle of rum in his front seat, would you say, you know, in possession of a drug suspected to be alcohol?
No. No, they would just come out and say there were charges based on, you know, open alcohol bottles, et cetera, et cetera. They wouldn't sugarcoat it at all.
Right. So yeah. It bugs me. That's why I brought this story into today's report, because this kind of reporting bugs me. Even if it's a direct quote taken directly from the officer, then the officer is responsible for his choice of words. If the reporter took liberties to word it the way he wanted it, then the reporter is responsible for his choice of words. You're shining a spotlight on a product that's legal.
Yeah, you're re-stigmatizing something that we have worked so very, very hard, as well as the gentleman in our previous story has worked so hard to unstigmatize this medication. Right. Of cannabis. The second I read this story, I knew that you were going to put it in today. I knew, right?
Yeah. Now, is the guy, you know, responsible? Absolutely. We all make our own choices. You knew that you were in breach if you did this. You did it anyway. Well, yeah. You made your choice, right? We aren't supposed to have cannabis readily available and access to the driver. It's the same rule that follows the alcohol laws. It can't be accessed readily available to the driver. Improper storage of your cannabis while operating a motor vehicle is a ticket for everybody yep. else. It doesn't make the news.
They... You know, I'm sure it's happened. It happens with alcohol and all the time. And we don't see stories on it such as this.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's what bugs me about this. You know, you want to shine a light on this particular person because he was in breach. Do that. But you didn't have to add in this spotlight on possession of drugs.
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, they could have, like, as you mentioned, they could have easily, I mean, if he was out before, you know, this without, they could have easily got him on that breach long before this. They were definitely following him around and they were looking to re-stigmatize the medicine of cannabis. And yeah, I'm with you on this one. It's very infuriating seeing it.
Yeah. So yeah, really pissed me off. Article in Timmins today. Small town, Northern Ontario, doing its thing. I had to bring that up. We're going to go from there to our next one in the grow shop. You want to grab the headline?
Absolutely. Brewing Buds, big beer corporations enter the cannabis industry, which we all knew was coming. Medical cannabis advocate and craft beer lover Paul Lewin examines the impact big beer could have on the cannabis-infused beer landscape.
Yeah,
it's kind of exciting.
Yeah, Paul Lewin is, of course, a lawyer. Jack Lloyd, who we all know and love, did his tutelage under him. Paul represented Matt Murnaugh in his case as well here in Ontario, which, you know, changed a lot of things for the way cannabis is handled by the government today. So, I mean, Paul is a great, great friend of the cannabis community and headed Normal as well, worked for Normal Canada as well for many years. I think he still does. So the rising tide of legal cannabis commerce is finally attracting the attention of so-called big beer corporations, and with good reason, he says. Over the past 7 years, home and craft breweries carved a niche for themselves by participating with hemp farms and wholesale retailers with cannabis terpenes for sale to make infused beer, a novel and unique new line of products in a once oversaturated beer market. So I guess the market is looking at this as a new product to rejuvenate the industry.
Absolutely. And I mean, I think it will. Like, I mean, since 2017, big beer has slowly begun to test the waters with infused beer space with the rollout of a number of experimental products. You know, And it goes on to tell us, you know, what they constitute as to be a big beer company. You know, it has to do with their scale of operation, their brewing process, degree of independence.
Examples, of course, Miller, Coors, Molson, Coors, Constellation Brand, Anheuser-Busch, Heineken. You know, there's several of them that we all recognize as big beer. And they all are part of the Brewers Association, American Trade Group. And, you know, and that's the corporate level of big beer. So the article goes on to talk about different stuff that's going on in different countries. You know, there's experiments going on in California, dispensaries and novelty markets that are making huge strides. And of course, right here in Canada, Constellation Brands is in it with significant growth opportunities, according to this article.
The corporation behind the brewery Modelo and Corona have made history by being the first big beer entity to officially invest in the legal cannabis industry. They did this by buying up 10% of the Canadian-based Canopy Growth in October of 2017. And by 2018, the company has pumped well over $4 billion into Canopy Cannabis.
Yeah, $4 billion. Yeah. That's a lot of money this. And lots and lots of money going into this, you know. Until cannabis is legalized at a federal level in the United States, legal cannabis industry is pretty much at a standstill. They can only go state to state. And because of, you know, travel restrictions and this and that, they pretty much have to set up in each and every individual state. So that's the big goal here is national legalization down in the USA to grow that market. You know, Japan is in on it with Japanese big beer tests going on in the U.S. market with a new Belgian brewing company.
Yeah, it started in March of 2018 in Colorado, big surprise. They announced a hemp-infused Hemperer HPA made with hemp seeds. Well, that's really kind of cool. Although prudent in its use of non-psychoactive strain of cannabis, New Belgium hasn't been coy in its support of cannabis activism. In July 2018, CEO Steve Fescheimer joined forces with GCH Incorporated, which is a legal cannabis company founded by country singer Willie Nelson. Together, they partnered with Vote Hemp Organization to advocate for federal and state reform of laws encumbering the hemp industry, as well as for the removal of cannabis from the U.S. Drug Enforcement Administration, which, you know, like Willie Nelson, of course, is huge in trying to make cannabis, you know, legal across the states. I think it's wonderful that he's working with these people to bring out an infused beer.
Yeah, for sure. You know, and of course, most of course, they've got the Canadian beer market with an eye on the U.S. So, I mean, everybody's waiting for the legalization aspect to happen on a nationwide level out in the U.S. so that they can advance into that market. Huge dollar signs in all of their eyes. The article goes on, you know, to talk about playing the long game and the legislators fighting on Capitol Hill. But, you know, the gist of it is, big beer is in it, and they're in it for the long game.
Absolutely.
Yeah, they're in it for the long game. Our next article is our final one before we go for our break. We're going to look at a story coming to us from Frontier.
This one makes me smile.
Yeah, this one makes all of us really, really smile. A good one to go out on break with. With few options, Cannabis Lounge becomes Oklahoma Town's only shelter for the homeless during the recent deep freeze.
Yeah, they've been hit pretty hard down there with snow and cold. So faced with more than a week of sub-freezing temperatures, ice and several inches of snow, a Cannabis Lounge in Wagoner has stepped up to serve as the town's only warming station and shelter service for the town's homeless population. Bud's Lounge on Maine began offering shelter and warming services as well as food, clothing, and blankets to those in need on Saturday after a discussion on the town's Facebook page raised the issue of what was being done to help the town's homeless population during the deep freeze. Wow. Amazing. Cannabis and Lounge steps up.
There we go, right? You owe me a Coke. totally. This is who steps up. We've seen this time and time again. You know, when there's a need, the cannabis community answers the call. Initially, the lounge was offering public warming stations to those who lost power last week, according to the co-owner, Sarah Hutt Greenman. But when she and her mother, Jane Stiles, who is also a co-owner of Buds, saw the Facebook post on Friday asking what was being done, they decided to open the lounge and shelter and start providing food and clothing. So, I mean, that's amazing. They started off with a small thing. They saw the need was so great, and they expanded that greatly. And, you know, the word got out through social media. Where is the rest of the town? They're all chatting on social media about it, but it took somebody in the cannabis community to put those words into action.
Yeah, and since Saturday, they have provided overnight shelter to 9 people, provided food care packages, clothing, blankets to 24 people experiencing homelessness, including children. Yeah. About 20 people per day use the warming station. And some people who are not homeless, but, you know, are struggling financially right now, come by to get needed supplies that are donated by the community. And get this, we're going to read into it, but the community folks, the police are donating and supporting this.
That is fantastic. And the Vapor Lounge, you know, a place where people go to commute. So there are, you know, there are couches and love seats and chairs and tables. And, you know, it's nice and warm and it's clean and it's welcoming. But they're illegal here.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Which is sad. Everything that they're doing for the community. And, we had a lounge here at one point in time in the community, and they were huge in the community. And it saddens me that they're not legal here. I mean, if we read on, Deputy Police Chief of Wagoner, Tony Pond, said Buds was the only option he was aware of in the Wagoner for people to look for shelter or a public warming station. We have people, unfortunately, who don't have anything, Pond said. We're just glad Buds stepped up to the plate to do what they did. That is the police chief saying that.
God that the chief in the United States said thank God for Buds. I mean how epic is that, you know? There are homeless people in other areas, and they camp out in, you know, different areas. So I mean there's other avenues that could open their doors, and hopefully other people will see what Buds has done and they'll jump on board to help.
Absolutely.
You know, I mean, this is absolutely fantastic. The Wagoner Police Department is also accepting clothing donations in a box in the lobby of the police station, Pond said, but has sent everything it had gathered over to Buds once they offer to provide food, shelter, and clothing to those in need.
Fantastic. You guys should see this picture. It's absolutely beautiful. We've got a table overrun with everything. I mean we've got you know, socks and everything there. Once Buds put it out that they were going to house and feed.
Fantastic. Fantastic.
Yeah, they also partnered with Healthy Food for Oklahomians, which is accepting for donations for food purchases. So the lounge is also hoping to eventually begin a community garden. So they're expanding on this. You know, they started with, oh my gosh, people are cold, let's help them, and they're going to take it all the way. So they're going to help. They're going to you know, put together a community garden to help feed people. You know, it really is an issue, and it's going to continue to be an issue even after the snow. There's a bigger picture here. That's the owner of Bud's speaking up. And while it may seem unusual for a cannabis lounge to be offering shelter, food, and clothing to the homeless, those services are sorely needed in Wagoner. And I don't think it's very unusual that cannabis lounge or folks, you know, step up to offer this to anybody in need.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And it's fantastic. I mean, the recognition that this is a problem and that nobody else has addressed. You're taking it from, okay, well, I can do this. I can let you get warmed up. And then it evolved into, okay, well, we're going to give you some food and let you stay the night. And, oh, look, we've got some supplies for you. Now it's evolved into, okay, when spring comes, we should make a garden. And, you know, it's going to keep going from there. But I love it so much because, of course, it was the lazy couch potato stoner that made all this happen.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I mean, like, we get creative when we're feeling well, and that's what cannabis helps us do, is to feel well.
Right. That's right.
So we get creative when this happens, when our pain dies down, our anxiety goes away. And this is what we can do when we get creative. And I think that, I think it's just absolutely gorgeous. And I mean, you see this happening all over the place. Like, I mean, whether it's here in Nova Scotia or out in Vancouver or, you know, in Ontario, or down in the States. I mean, this is happening everywhere. And I love these stories. They're just so happy and uplifting.
Yeah, absolutely. Just wonderful, wonderful story to see. Destigmatizing one more time and crushing the stereotype of the lazy couch potato stoner, because sorry guys, but that's not who we are. And once again, it took the cannabis community to step up for this this region. Great to see, for sure. And on that note, I think it's dab time. That's right. Mm-hmm. It's vacation time, which means we're going to hear from our sponsors, and then Cindy and I will be right back after the break. You're listening to the Reefer Reporters live here at paceradio.net.
You're listening to the Pace Radio Network here at paceradio.net.
At Legacy 420, we believe in being different.
Experience the difference of quality control.
Our labs provide tested formulations for all of our products.
Experience the difference in trust.
Our customers can trust that we are following up-to-date COVID precautions for their safety.
Experience the difference in accessibility.
We're open 7 days a week. Please visit our website, legacy420.com, or contact us for curbside pickup as well as nationwide mail order shipping.
Legacy 420 values overall wellness.
Come and experience the difference of Legacy 420.
Enjoy the buzz of legalization with Campbellford Lifestyle Shop. From lights to plant nutrients, books, consumption accessories, and more, we've got all your basics to grow or consume cannabis. Visit our info center or take a look at our piercing services and body jewelry, now available in-store through Campbellford Lifestyle Shop, 17 Bridge Street West, Campbellford.
What do you find at paceradio.net? People advocating cannabis education.
A doctor's job is to relieve your pains. And when it comes to growing cannabis, the biggest pain is trimming. Let Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions take the pain away. Whether you're a home grower or a commercial operation, we have the cure. From 4 plants to 400 plants, garden size doesn't matter. Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions comes to you with years of experience and professional discreet service. It's simple. We trim your weed and we do a damn good job. Visit drbuckcts.com to book your trimming.
CTCP operates a medicinal cannabis signing clinic. If you want to grow your own medicinal cannabis and are located anywhere in Canada, then I'd like to suggest that you give them a call. They can be reached at 1-613-967-9888. That's 1-613-967-9888. And grow on with CTCP.
Growing your own vegetables, flowers, or even medicinal plants can be a challenge without the right equipment and proper know-how. At BMA Hydroponics, not only are they your urban horticultural experts and suppliers, but their staff holds the customer's needs paramount to making a sale. Family-owned with decades of experience and knowledge, they offer free advice in person, by phone, or email. BMA Hydroponics wants to ensure you have the advice you need, which is why you'll find tips and tricks on different ways to grow, like wick, ebb and flow, drip, or aeroponic system, as well as other helpful links at bmahydroponics.com. If you can't find what you're looking for, just let them know, and they'll do everything they can to get what you're looking for. At BMA Hydroponics, each staff member also possesses a federal exemptee MMAR license, making their strong suit empathy, experience, and dedication to their customers. Because when you know how to grow, you'll have results that make you proud. BMA Hydroponics in Belleville, Ontario. Visit bmahydroponics.com.
We are people advocating cannabis education here at paceradio.net.
Hello, and we're back from our medication session. And yep, we are the Reefer Reporters. If you're not sure, we're live. We're always live here at paceradio.net. If you do miss our live show, don't forget they are available afterwards as a podcast at our website or on audio apps that are too numerous to mention. Oh, Spreaker, Spotify, CastBox, SoundCloud, Google, Apple Podcasts, you name it. Look us up. We're out there. Check us out, paceradio.net or the Pace Radio Network. I'm joined back with my joint host for another five stories that we've got in global cannabis news.
Absolutely. The next story comes to us from Normal. Clinical trial, cannabis inhalation associated with clinical improvement in patients with colitis.
Ulcerative colitis, big deal, right? Like, a lot of people suffer with gut issues, and this is one of the major ones.
Did I lose you?
No, I'm here.
Okay, sorry. This is really exciting. The inhalation of cannabis is associated with clinical improvements and increased quality of life in patients with mild to moderate ulcerative colitis, UC. According to the randomized placebo-controlled trial published by the journal PLOS One, PLOS One,
yeah. Israel. I mean, again, Israel, right? Israel with studies. Israel's up there with their studies. The research compared herbal cannabis versus placebo over an 8-week period in 32 patients. There was a protocol that they followed. You know, they had to do it so many times. And the researchers reported from clinical perspective, they found that treatment with cannabis led to a significant reduction in the LTA index, an 8-item measure designed to assess disease activities in patients with ulcerative colitis across 8 symptoms. So, I mean, major improvement in the IBD-related clinical symptoms, including abdominal pain and bowel movements. This is big news for people with gut-related issues.
It's very exciting. They concluded that this study demonstrates treatment with a THC-rich cannabis in patients with mild to moderate UC is associated with clinical improvement. The preliminary observation requires additional investigation and larger and longer intervention clinical studies, and they will be able to determine whether cannabis has mainly a symptom relieving role or a more specific anti-inflammatory therapeutic effect. I can't wait.
Yeah, I love this because THC rich. You know, we've been seeing a migration away from THC with a lot of medicines being produced. There's this huge bandwagon going on trying to grab up everybody to go on to CBD or no THC hemp-derived CBD. Eliminating the THC, you're taking one of the wheels off a bus. A bus cannot drive with 3 wheels. And that's what I have said from the start with this whole push towards CBD. CBD is awesome. It's another great element in the cannabis plant. But again, it is one element. CBD alone will not work. THC alone will not work. It's the entourage effect is what's required. Now, we can tweak the amounts of these components in a particular medicine or a particular plant so that strain will now be geared to what you want to use it for. But pulling them out and using them independently is not a good plan, in my opinion, from my own personal experience and my own personal research. It doesn't work that way. A whole plant remedy is what is needed. So I really love the fact that this one is focusing on the element of THC being the trigger.
Yeah, and they're not saying THC only, so they're following the same entourage as you, THC rich. They are bringing it back in with the rest of the cannabinoids, and And I completely agree with you on that one. I think, I mean, like, you know, FICO is the way to full extract. I mean, you want everything from the plant. And that's the way it works. And it works well if you keep it together.
That's right. That's right. You can tweak your recipes. You can tweak your elements. Absolutely. Increase one over the other. You know, you can do that genetically through growing, through crossbreeding. And create the perfect plant for that scenario. That absolutely can be done. Enriching elements within the plant, but continuing to use the whole plant. And that's why this particular study really caught my eye. I'm glad to see that somebody's going back into that direction. So the survey data did indicate that cannabis use is relatively common among patients with inflammatory bowel disease. And observational data has previously shown that cannabis may alleviate symptoms of certain IBD-related disorders like Crohn's. So, you know, we know what works, and we're already doing it. So it's about time the science catches up.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, we've been proving it for years, and it's nice to have the figurative piece of paper to put on the wall to say it's true.
Right, yeah. Exactly. We're going to go from study to study today. Next story coming to us from MSN, Market Watch News story. Mystery, marijuana mystery. Fewer older people file workers' compensation claims in states where cannabis is legalized.
That's interesting.
Yeah. So seniors are finding relief and going to work.
Yeah. In an ongoing debate over cannabis full legalization, a new study offers proponents this potential payoff, cheaper worker compensation claims for injured workers. In states that legalized full adult recreational cannabis between 2010 and 2018, fewer older workers filed workers' compensation claims. And when they did, the payouts tended to be smaller, according to new research distributed by the National Bureau of Economic Research.
Yeah. Employers, of course, pay into workers' compensation funds, which provide an income for injured employees who can't work. But when workers in pain have easier access to cannabis as a form of chronic pain management, that may reduce their need to altogether for workers' compensation and keep them working, according to The Economist at the Temple University, University in Cincinnati. So, I mean, they've run the numbers, and places that have pot shops, they don't take time off.
Yeah. And I mean, of course, if you have less people taking time off with workers' compensation and you have, you know, less injury reports going in because of that, your workers' compensation rates go down. So the employers save money as well.
That's so right. Your rates go down. So employers are happy to see this. So, you know, the whole, the sky is going to fall and nobody's going to go to work. Everybody's just going to sit at home and smoke pot and the economy is going to go to shit. And, you know, all of these horrors that were predicted with legalization, the opposite is happening.
Absolutely. I just got to say off topic, I love how you remind me of stuff that I don't even think of in the moment. Thank you. And you're absolutely right. I mean, the stigma of, you know, we're all couch potatoes is really being squashed with this story. So, yeah, when workers have easier access, they can manage. I mean, once cannabis becomes legal for recreational use amongst adults, many people use it for medical purposes, including pain management. This is the professor of Temple University, Catherine McLean, speaking, and she's one of the study's authors. McLean and her colleagues combed through recurring Bureau of Labor Statistics surveys that questioned more than 500,000 people, including asking whether the person received workers' compensation and if so, how much. So they found it dropped.
Yeah, 20% fewer.
Yeah.
20%, yeah. That's big.
It's huge. And it was $21.98 over out of every $100 that it dropped. That's amazing.
In a corporate level, that's big money. Yeah. So, you know, of course, the findings do echo McLean's past research, which found a 13% decline in workers' compensation claims for older adults as medical marijuana statutes spread from 1990 to 2012. Of course, that all began in California with legalization of med there, and the dispensaries started popping up. So, you know, when you scrutinize the time frame from 2010 to 2008, eight states and the District of Washington, D.C., authorized recreational adult use. So that should account for the increase in stats. But that just shows you this isn't isolated to an area. This is a nationwide effect.
Yeah, yeah. I'm losing my words. I do apologize. The study also comes as Americans grapple everywhere with opioids. So, I mean, it's not just making an effect on workers' compensation. I mean, people are getting rid of potent painkillers and therefore can come back to work faster because they're not having to fight the addiction after they've taken it for a week. They can just take their can of caps and off they go back to work with no withdrawal symptoms.
And they don't become the couch potato because of the pharmaceuticals that they're taking. Because, you know, let's face it, these opiates, that's what puts you in the brain fog. That's what sticks your ass in bed and on the couch where you can't move, you can't think, you can't function because you're over-medicated on an opiate that is shutting your systems down. So how can you effectively go to work in that state? Cannabis is replacing those, and lo and behold, you can go to work.
Yeah. Yeah. The study also points to past research saying opiate-related deaths can drop between 20 and 35% as legal cannabis becomes prevalent.
Amazing. Saving lives. Saving lives. Like, come on. Where's the rest of the world on this? You know, where are the rest of the United States? Where are they at a federal level? We're saving lives here across the board from vapor lounges, saving the homeless from the cold, to saving seniors time off work and saving lives from addiction. So encouraging stuff coming out of these studies.
And McLean, she wants to point out that her and her co-authors are not trying to pick sides on the debate on cannabis. They're just trying to research the findings and have them speak for themselves. So I want to put that out there too. She's not pro or con on either side. She just wants to find the truth.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah. Let's figure this out and just deal with the reality of it instead of going on innuendo and past prohibition BS that's out there. So yeah, for sure. Good stuff. Good stuff. From one study to another. Big milestone that's happening in the United States because of largely because of the studies that are coming out.
this story actually ties in with the last one. As people don't have to take time off work, large employers in Maine are drop cannabis from drug screening.
Yeah, so I mean, Maine is on board. They're seeing these studies while they're not taking time off work because of pot, so why are we screening for it? Awesome sauce, way to go, Maine. Maine companies with tens of thousands of employees will drop THC from drug testing protocols due to widespread cannabis use and lack of reliable testing procedures, according to the article. Several large employers are no longer testing employees or potential hires for cannabis, according to the Portland Press Herald. Companies are still testing for other illegal drugs, but have not decided not to include THC in their testing protocols.
Yeah, since last October, this is really exciting. Bath Iron Works is one of the companies. So their spokesman, David Hench, told the Press Herald that the company planned to hire more than 2,700 people this year, and that precluding cannabis users for most of the positions was not prudent. Bath Iron Works is owned by defense contractor General Dynamics. So the company will still include THC testing for certain jobs, but for the majority of them, they're going to dump it.
Yeah. The key word, safety sensitive, a lot of companies here in Canada are taking advantage of those, of that term, safety sensitive, quote unquote, and making, you know, not safety sensitive positions now to be included in that category just to get around this kind of protocol. But it's good to see that Maine is not gone in that direction and they actually have a brain. So Maine Health, the state's largest private employer with about 22,000 employees, stopped including THC screening last November, according to spokesman John Porter. And he said the changes were made in light of evolving state laws.
Yeah, that's really exciting. It stopped including it. So this is Maine Health. Kristen Collins, an attorney with Portland Law, told the Press Herald that the simple fact that someone uses cannabis does not mean they're going to be an unsafe employee. She noted that federal guidelines require some employees to be tested for cannabis, such as those requiring a commercial driver's license, some education programs, and jobs requiring to use a firearm. So they really are trying to narrow what jobs, what the job is actually doing versus just making it up.
Yeah. So it's encouraging to see that they're going to do this kind of separation. And I think they're picking out these ones that are in criteria with federal guidelines, because of course down there, federally cannabis is still illegal. So if you're on a federal position, then they have to test for it because that is the federal statute and they can't go beyond that, waive that in a state level. But if it's a sort of a state-run job that isn't safety-sensitive, then they simply don't give a shit anymore. And that's wonderful to see, especially given the past studies that we just talked about. So, I mean, employers can still legally test applicants for cannabis. And according to the State Department of Labor, 540 Maine businesses have state-approved testing requirements. But the agency found that 7% positivity rate are on 26,173 drug tested performed in the state. It was the highest rate since the drug testing program was recreated in 1989. So, you know, cannabis accounted for 92% of those positive tests, according to the report. So this, I guess they're looking at it saying, well, if we test anybody, there's not going to be anybody to work.
Yep.
You know, because everybody smokes pot here now because it's legal. So what are we doing? It doesn't make sense.
So they thought about it with a logical brain and decided that it was time to get rid of it off their drug screening.
Yeah. So way to go, Maine. Yay, Maine. Big applause for Maine for sure. From the U.S. of A., we're gonna jump on the jet and travel with some High Times.
Yes. Parlez-vous Cannabis Medicinal? That's my best French accent. I do apologize. The French begins national medicinal cannabis trials. So this is kind of exciting. The French at long last have decided to move forward on validating cannabis as medicine, and they are doing it differently than anyone else in Europe so far.
Leave it to France to go their own way. Gotta love it. France has bowed to the inevitable, according to the story. After several years of promises about normalizing the discussion and failing to do so, and further indirect in contrast to its German, Dutch, Danish, and even Swiss and Spanish neighbors, the country has finally caved in, recognizing that medical cannabis has at least theoretical efficacy.
Their first trial, which was delayed for much of 2020, was publicized last fall, right as the European Commission decided that CBD was not a narcotic, and as the WHO voted to remove cannabis from the global schedule for status.
Yeah,
which is really exciting for that to happen. And this timing is not accidental. The country's ever savvy politician, Machiavellian on the topic, President Emmanuel Macron, was there belatedly to cheer it on. Just finishing the line of just at the finishing line of done and dusted. In the late in late January, the country chooses its finalists.
It's exciting stuff going on over there, right?
Yeah. And why this trial is different.
Yeah, hopefully this time is different. There is a lot of criticism in the room. You know, it's an important step for sure, and not just for France, but for a range of decisions now literally haunting the industry, if not in full reform discussion across the EU and elsewhere. I mean, and it's true that we do stories on the evolving situation in the EU all the time, and they're constantly changing their minds over there. First, CBD wasn't going to be a novel food item, then it was, and then it wasn't. And, you know, they're debating on only allowing what they call cannabis light, which is basically hemp with low limits of CBD and high concentrations, or sorry, low limits of THC and high concentrations of CBD. So, I mean, they're kind of flapping around in the middle of the water there without a life jacket over in Europe. So it's great to see France saying, you know what, we're doing something.
Absolutely. They're stepping up and trying to get it done. But anyone that expects it to all go smoothly and without major mistakes, has clearly not been paying attention to the disasters that have so far ensued, according to this article. Everywhere, when a country or a region takes up actual implementation of cannabis reform, if you watch the U.S. state markets, the Canadian national one, and faults in both the German and as well as the Dutch medicinal, or the German medicinal and the Dutch recreational bids. However, there are indications that the French, have been watching and are trying to learn from everybody else's mistakes.
Yeah, absolutely. First, according to this, they say the first fascinating difference, apart from the inclusion of non-Canadian firms, is that the tender bid mandated that corporate participants also cover all the costs of the medicine and devices required. So, I mean, they've laid out, I'm not going to read it, word for word and paragraph for paragraph, but they've laid out a plan, and they've obviously done some research, and they said, this is what it costs money and this is what people need. So if we're going to do this, we're going to do it right. So maybe them sitting back and taking some time is going to pay off for them.
Yeah, I think it will. I mean, everybody will be watching and, looking to see what they do and how they're doing it. I'm excited to see what comes next for them.
Yeah, yeah. Vive la France.
Yeah. they're probably not going to lead in any cannabis revolution on research. They're going to take their time and they're going to try and do it right.
Yeah. That's what it looks like. Europe's medicinal trials, are they critical for North America? Well, yeah. Because, many times with medicine, Europe leads the way, and what happens over here in North America are North American scientists that pick up the ball where that gets begun over in that country. So yeah, it's absolutely pertinent here.
Yeah, it's exciting. I'm excited to see what they do and what the outcome of this study is going to be.
Yeah. I'm gonna skip right down to the bottom and says in the United States and Canada, however, so far the entire discussion has been mute, and for a wide range of reasons, including the fact that widespread trials are difficult to get approved in the United States. We're back to that issue that's been kind of, prevalent throughout today's show. United States getting on board at a federal level will advance things enormously in North America.
Absolutely. Fingers are crossed that is starting to happen for them down there.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. We're going to go to our final story of the day. Love this one. It's kind of fun. We're throwing it in here. Of course, expansion here at the network. We are, yes, a cannabis, people advocating cannabis education. But we are also all about natural medicine, natural therapies,
and things found in nature. And our final story for today is coming to us from the Gunjapreneur. And I love the picture of the gentleman on the cover of this and the wonderful hippie trippy background. Zappy Zapolin, the American Psychedelic Resurgence. As an entrepreneur, Michael Zappy Zapolin is known as a pioneer in the domain name industry. As a filmmaker, he has emerged as a powerful advocate for the legalization and normalization of psychedelics.
Yeah, this is exciting. Between new cannabis legalization laws, decriminalization efforts, and discoveries related to medical psilocybin and other psychedelic substances, recent years have marked a resurgence for psychedelics in U.S. culture, politics, and medicine. Zappy Zapolin is the filmmaker and activist behind The Reality of Truth, a documentary that follows a Hollywood movie star, Michelle Rodriguez, and several of her friends through a journey of personal discovery fueled by psychedelics, which is I've never heard of this one before. I will be watching it.
Yeah, me too. I'm interested to see it, you know, especially with our new adventure getting started here. It's great to see that that's happening all over the place, it's fascinating stuff for sure. In this episode at Gunjapreneur.com, podcast is available for people to watch, and you can check them out. Zappy joining the host TG Banfalt, and they discuss the resurgence of psychedelics in America, American politics and culture, drug decriminalization, developments from last November's election, and the latest medicinal discoveries related to psychedelic substances, including ketamine, psilocybin, as well as cannabis. So the conversation also covers Zappy's transition from early digital era pioneer to activist and filmmaker, and how psychedelics can help society recover from the collective trauma that we're all experiencing during our certain uncertain times.
Yeah. And on this article, the podcast is attached. So you can listen to the interview through the media player below or through any of your favorite podcast listening platforms, which Kim at the beginning of the program listed off a number of them. And you can scroll down on this particular story, and you can read the whole podcast as well. They have it typed out for you if you would rather read it.
Yeah. So it's, you can read it as a story, or you can watch the podcast or listen to it through your headset. I have not watched this podcast yet. I caught this story yesterday, and I haven't had a chance to watch it. I've been so swamped, but it's on my list of things to play while I'm busy working on other things pretty much immediately after today's show, which is right now, because Absolutely. That was our final story of the day, my dear.
Absolutely. And I am the same as you. I've got two podcasts I'm going to go listen to while I do my afternoon errands.
Yeah, absolutely. Busy here at the Pace Radio Network, as well as IWK on Facebook. So thank you, everybody, for joining us today, listening to our Reefer Report. And that is it for the day today. On Thursday, February the 18th in 2021, from the legacy420.com news desk, we'd like to say thank you for listening to our Reefer Report here at paceradio.net. If you enjoyed it, please share it with those you love and even those you don't. We'll bark at you later.
The opinions of the individuals during this broadcast are their own and may not be the opinions of their group or other organizations they may be involved with.
You're listening to the Pace Radio Network here at paceradio.net.
At Legacy 420, we believe in being different.
Experience the difference of quality control.
Our labs provide tested formulations for all of our products.
Experience the difference in trust.
Our customers can trust that we are following up-to-date COVID precautions for their safety.
Experience the difference in accessibility.
We're open 7 days a week. Please visit our website, legacy420.com, or contact us for curbside pickup as well as nationwide mail order shipping.
Legacy 420 values overall wellness.
Come and experience the difference of Legacy 420.
Enjoy the buzz of legalization with Campbellford Lifestyle Shop. From lights to plant nutrients, books, consumption accessories, and more, we've got all your basics to grow or consume cannabis. Visit our info center or take a look at our piercing services and body jewelry, now available in-store through Campbellford Lifestyle Shop, 17 Bridge Street West, Campbellford.
What do you find at paceradio.net? People advocating cannabis education.
CTCP operates a medicinal cannabis signing clinic. If you want to grow your own medicinal cannabis and are located anywhere in Canada, then I'd like to suggest that you give them a call. They can be reached at 1-613-967-9888. That's 1-613-967-9888. And grow on with CTCP.
Growing your own vegetables, flowers, or even medicinal plants can be a challenge without the right equipment and proper know-how. At VMA Hydroponics, not only are they your urban horticultural experts and suppliers, but their staff holds the customer's needs paramount to making a sale. Family-owned with decades of experience and knowledge, they offer free advice in person, by phone, or email. VMA Hydroponics wants to ensure you have the advice you need, which is why you'll find tips and tricks on different ways to grow, like wick, ebb and flow, drip, or aeroponic system, as well as other helpful links at vmahydroponics.com. If you can't find what you're looking for, just let them know, and they'll do everything they can to get what you're looking for. At VMA Hydroponics, each staff member also possesses a federal exemptee MMAR license, making their strong suit empathy, experience, and dedication to their customers. Because when you know how to grow, you'll have results that make you proud. VMA Hydroponics in Belleville, Ontario. Visit vmahydroponics.com.
A doctor's job is to relieve your pains. And when it comes to growing cannabis, the biggest pain is trimming. Let Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions take the pain away. Whether you're a home grower or a commercial operation, we have the cure. From 4 plants to 400 plants, garden size doesn't matter. Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions comes to you with years of experience and professional discreet service. It's simple. We trim your weed and we do a damn good job. Visit drbuckcts.com to book your trimming.
Do you want to hear what patients and cannabis advocates have to say? If so, then catch the Pace Radio Show Wednesday nights here on paceradio.net.
We are people advocating cannabis education here at paceradio.net.